بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
Now, barakallahu feekum. We have our brother Abdul Hakeem online. Now, Maki, the Fadl.
In alhamdulillah. نحمده تعالى ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. أما بعد, thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the ni'mah of Islam and for the ni'mah of obedience and istiqamah of being steadfast. Already Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us the ni'mah of Islam and to live in a state of obedience to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And today, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's permission, I'd like to speak a small reminder for a short time due to the circumstances that we're currently in. أخرج إمام الترمذي عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أكثروا ذكر هذه من لذات يعني الموت. Imam al-Tirmidhi, his name is Muhammad ibn Isa. He narrated from the hadith of Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu. His name is differed upon, but what's the most correct is Abdurrahman ibn Sakhr. Abdurrahman ibn Sakhr. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, increase or be frequent in mentioning that which destroys the joys and pleasures, meaning al-maut, death. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this hadith, in this profound hadith, has commanded us to mention frequently and to remind one another frequently about that which, if you hear it, it destroys your joys and your pleasures, just by being reminded of it and hearing it, death. That you will die. You're going to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a reminder about that which destroys all joy and pleasures. Death. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he commanded in this hadith that we remind one another of death frequently. Akthiru, meaning do this often. Zikr hadin al-lazat. In some of the narrations is hadin. And no doubt that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam guides us to in it is benefit. Benefit for the believer. That is benefit for the obedient. The benefit of that is that you remember that you will return to your Lord, Allah who created you. And He will ask you about your deeds. And He will hold you responsible for your statements and your actions. أَكْثِرُوا ذِكْرَ هَذِي مِنْ لَذَّاتِ. Mention frequently the destroyer of pleasures. The ulama, they say, rahimahum Allah, that no believer who lives in comfort and luxury and in shelter and a spacious, comfortable life, no believer in this situation is reminded upon death, is reminded about death. He said it makes him feel uncomfortable and restrained and confined and tight. And no believer who's living in oppression and trials and tribulations hears about and is reminded about death, except that it gives him relief. He feels relief and he feels comfort. And he knows that the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is true, and that his reward for his obedience and his patience is close. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has mentioned death and reminded the believers about death throughout his book because of the benefit of that which is in it, for the benefit of the reminder. And it makes you forget the joys of this world. And we want to understand from that that nothing makes you forget death and that you're returning back to Allah and that He's going to hold you accountable of your deeds except the joys of this world. الله سبحانه وتعالى يقول في كتابه الكريم كل نفس ذائقة الموت. Every soul will taste death. وإنما توفون أجوركم يوم القيامة. And verily you will receive your full reward on the day of resurrection. فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةِ فَقَدْ فَازَ. So that the one who has been removed far from the fire and he has been entered into the Jannah, then he has succeeded. وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاءُ الْغُرُورِ. And what is the life of this world except deception? This is a profound ayah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In it is a lot of benefit and good and direction for the believers. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ بَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul will taste death. You might find the disbelievers or even the people of the bid'ah disagreeing with the people of the sunnah and the correct beliefs in all kinds of issues. As far as death, then they admit that everybody is going to die.
3 billion people will be using the internet by 2015.
Every soul will taste death.
Required world is that more than 60%
of traffic. You will receive your full reward on Yawm al-Qiyamah, the day of resurrection. So the one has been removed from the fire and entered in the Jannah, this is the one who's successful. This is what you keep in mind. And what is the life of this world except deception and distraction? To distract you from remembering that you need deeds, you're returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He created you to worship Him. Nothing distracts you from the obedience to Allah except the joys of this world. But on night, but at dusk, it takes away these joys and reminds you of reality and helps you to keep your eyes on the prize. With that in mind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has informed us on how we should die. فيقول ربنا تبارك وتعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. All you who believe, fear Allah as He ought to be feared, and don't die except as Muslims. Meaning, in a state, don't die except in a state of obedience and submissiveness and surrendering yourself to Allah and to the commandments and the prohibitions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has stated. Do not die except you're in a state of submissiveness to Allah. This requires that you live constantly in a state of submissiveness. So my dear brother, you have to prepare for meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you have to prepare for death. And you are in need of good deeds. You're in need of having good deeds. So that when you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He can reward you fully for your deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يقول في كتابه الكريم يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تلهكم أموالكم ولا أولادكم عن ذكر الله ومن يفعل ذلك فأولئك هم الخاسرون. Oh, you who believe, do not allow your money and your children to distract you, to distract you from the remembrance of Allah. And whoever does that, then he's from amongst the losers. وَأَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتِ. And spend from your wealth that which we provided you with before death comes to one of you. فَيَقُولُ رَبِّ لَوْلَا أَخَّرْتَنِي إِلَىٰ أَجْرٍ قَرِيبٍ. He's going to say, oh my Lord, why don't you delay me to a time, or to a close time, or another time of death. Don't you delay me a little bit. فَأَصَّدَّقَ وَأَكُنْ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. And therefore I would donate and spend my money and I would be from amongst the righteous. وَلَنْ يُؤَخِّرُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِذَا جَاءَ أَجْلُهَا. And Allah will not delay. Allah will not delay the time of death from any person. وَاللَّهُ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. And Allah is well aware of that which you do. These ayahs are profound, is upon the believer to contemplate about them. Allah says, oh you who believe, do not let your money and your children distract you from the remembrance of Allah. And whoever does that, then he's amongst the losers. And spend your wealth that we provided you with before death comes to one of you. Then he's going to say, oh my Lord, why don't you give me more time so that I can spend my money and give charity and be amongst the righteous. He wants more time when death comes for what? To make more money? No. To sit with his kids and spend time with his wife? No. He wants to do more deeds. So it's upon you to recognize this. That Allah said, do not, لا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Do not die except that you're in a state of obedience to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't be amongst those that are deficient in their deeds, that when death comes to them, they want more time so they can do more deeds. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتِ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ لَأَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِيمَا تَرَكْتْ كَلَّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, until one of you, or until death comes to one of you, he says, oh my Lord, send me back. Send me back to the world, to the life of the world, to the dunya. Until death comes to one of you, قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ. Oh my Lord, send me back so that perhaps I will do righteous deeds. I will do the righteous deeds that I left off. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kalla, no. And the disobedient, and those who are deficient in their deeds, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala snatches their souls, they say, it's not just something that they are wishing or feeling, قَالَ رَبِّ رَجِعُونَ, they say, oh my Lord, send me back. So you, my dear listener, don't you be from amongst those that say that, because of lack of deeds. Don't be from amongst those that say that. قَالَ رَبِّ رَجِعُونَ لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا, so that perhaps I could do good deeds. فِيمَا تَرَكْتُ, and that which I left off. The deeds that he didn't do while he was in the life of this world. So it's upon you to reflect upon death all the time. Every day in Salah, how many times do you say, مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ, the owner of the Yawm al-Din, of the day of resurrection. So the person who is deficient in his deeds, when he dies, he wants to return to this world, not in order to make more money, or to try to get another car, try to get another furniture set, or get married. He's not thinking about the joys of this dunya. So it's not for you to be distracted from the joys of this dunya. He wants to return so that he can do more deeds, good deeds, righteous deeds. But the time is too late. Once death comes, وَلَنْ يُؤَخِّرُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِذَا جَاءَ أَجْلُهَا, Allah will not delay any person if his time has come to die. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يقول في كتابه الكريم, وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتٌ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and no soul knows what deeds he's going to bring forth tomorrow, and no soul knows in what land he's going to die. So none of us know what's in tomorrow, what tomorrow's going to bring. Nor do we know the land that we're going to die in. What comes on Abu al-Izz, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ قَبْضَ عَبْدٍ بِأَرْضٍ جَعَلَ لَهُ إِلَيْهَا حَاجَةً, if Allah wants to snatch or take the soul of his servant, if Allah wants to snatch the soul of his servant in a particular land, he makes him have in this land a need that he has to go there and get. He gives him a need in this land that he needs to acquire. So, when somebody enters upon obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and is striving to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he dies, whether it be in Hajj, or whether it be visiting his brothers, or whether it be in seeking ilm, then this is a sign of faith. and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take our souls while we're in the state of obedience to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. It comes in Sahih al-Bukhari, and Ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Jannatu aqrabu ila ahadikum shirak na'li wal-naru mithu dhalik. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Jannah is closer to one of you than the lace on his shoe, on his slippers. And the hellfire is like that also. So death is ever close. And when somebody dies, he's either in the joys of Jannah or in the torment of the hellfire. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His mercy and to wipe away our sins and to pardon us for our shortcomings. Jannah aqrabu ila ahadikum min shiraki na'li. Jannah is closer to one of you, closer than the lace on your shoe. Jannah is closer to that. It's closer than that. And the hellfire is closer to you than that also. Hadith is in Bukhari and Ibn Mas'ud. So we have to ever be in a state of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول نفمة المؤمن في الجنة. The nafama of a Muslim is in Jannah, meaning the soul, the ruh of a Muslim is in Jannah. When a Muslim dies, he's in Jannah. His ruh, his soul is in Jannah. As for his body, then his body is buried in his grave. But when a Muslim dies, he goes to Jannah. These are the kind of things that make a believer enter upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the believer understands that when he dies, that he's in Jannah, and he's not afraid of dying, and he knows that he's upon obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من أحب لقاء الله أحب الله لقاءه. Whoever loves to meet Allah, Allah loves to meet him. ومن كره لقاء الله كره الله لقاءه. And whoever dislikes to meet Allah, then Allah dislikes to meet him. And now that all of us, we fear death. And there's no shortcomings in that. It's a natural feeling. But when somebody's upon obedience, then he's ever ready to meet Allah. And he knows that he dedicated his life to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one that makes wudu and makes salah every day and goes to the masjid, wears hijab, and stays away from fornication and drinking intoxicants. And he stays obedient to Allah. For what? So that when you die, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from His mercy rewards us in this world and in the next. In this world and in the next. But we are the ones, we are the believers, we are the Muslims. We
we dedicated our life to submissiveness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't have any kind of misunderstanding about death. As for the disbelievers, you will find that they don't even like to even speak about death. أكثروا ذكر هازم اللذات يعني الموت. Mention frequently, remind one another frequently about that which destroys the joy, meaning death. Disbelievers, they don't want to hear anything about death. You're a believer. You believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold you accountable for your deeds. You're the one that makes hajj. You're the one that gathers your money to make hajj. You're the one that takes your money and pays charity. You're the one that leaves off food during the month of Ramadan and relations. You're the one that wears a certain dress code. You're the one that stays away from haram. You're the ones that pick your friends based on the Quran and the Sunnah. You've devoted your life to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're the one who that believes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wrote down the day that you were going to die while you were in your mother's stomach. So all of this makes you comfortable and confident. All of this makes you comfortable and confident that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, He wants for you good, no matter where you are at, no matter how you die. Don't think that the one that dies on the 12th floor of that new modern hospital, that he's the one that died comfortably with all the machines hooked up to him, or that one that died were all around him with all his children, and they were reminding him and they were there for him, that this necessitates that he's up on cried and he was in comfort. And that one that died under the tree by himself, or in the hospital by himself, or in his room by himself, nobody knew that this is a bad death. Nah. The mas'ala is good deeds. إن الله لا ينظر إلى صوركم ولا إلى أجسامكم ولكن ينظر إلى قلوبكم وأعمالكم. Verily Allah does not look at your shapes and your sizes and your bodies. Rather, He looks at your deeds and your actions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He looks at your deeds and He looks at your actions. Make your concern that you die upon obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whoever dies upon obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by Allah, he's successful. By Allah, he's successful. He has succeeded. Whether he dies in prison, no shame whatsoever. And he is upon obedience to Allah, and he's upon submissiveness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then there's nothing for him to fear. For all of us, my dear brothers, death is close. For those who may be elderly and feel that death is ever close, rejoice if you are upon obedience to Allah and make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seek Allah's forgiveness. Beg Allah for His forgiveness. And do good deeds. And don't fear. Allah's promise is true. Allah's promise is true. That the ones who do good deeds, and that they, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will reward them. So, قد جاء في مسلم عن أبي بكر ابن أبي موسى الأشعري. The son of Abi Musa al-Ash'ari, his name is Abu Bakr. قال سمعت أبي رضي الله عنه
بحضرة العدو. I heard my father, يعني أبو موسى رضي الله عنه, say while he was in front of the enemy, while he was in fighting, in jihad, while he's fighting the enemy, and the enemy's in front of him. يقول قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن أبواب الجنة تحت ظلال السيوف. Verily, the doors of Jannah is under the shade of the swords. And if somebody, the shade of the sword is on top of him, meaning the sword is about to chop him. This is the gateway to Jannah. إِنَّ أَبْوَابَ الْجَنَّةِ تَحْتَ ظِلَالِ السُّيُوفِ. Verily, the gates of Jannah is under the shade of the sword. فَقَالَ الرَّجُلٌ يَسْرَفُ الْهَيْئَةِ. So a man whose appearance wasn't of neatness, he said, يَا أَبَا مُوسَى أَأَنْتَ سَمِعْتَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولْ هَذَا. This man said to Abu Musa, oh Abu Musa, did you hear the Messenger of Allah say this? قَالَ نَعَمْ. He said, yes. فَرَجَعَ إِلَىٰ أَصْحَابِهِ فَقَالَ أَقْرَى عَلَيْكُمُ السَّلَامِ. He went back to his companions, his companion went back to his friends and his companions and said, أَسْلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ. Then he broke the sheath of his sword and threw it on the side. Then he advanced to the enemy with his sword, and he fought with his sword until he was killed. He fought with his sword until he was killed. وجاء عن أنس that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met the disbelievers في يوم البدر. So when the disbelievers, they approached and confronted the Prophet and his companions, the Prophet wanted to tell the believers to advance and to charge and to fight. So how did he say that to them? قَالَ قُومُوا إِلَى جَنَّةٍ أَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ. He said, stand up, you know, advance to Jannah, to a garden. The width of it is the width of the heavens and the earth. He didn't say attack your enemy, go, fire, shoot. He said, stand up to Jannah, a garden that the width of it is the width of the heavens and the earth. قال يقول عمير ابن حمام الأنصاري رضي الله عنه يا رسول الله جنة أرضها السماوات والأرض. فعمير ابن حمام الأنصاري رضي الله عنه, he heard the Prophet say this. He said, Messenger of Allah, oh Messenger of Allah, a garden, its width is the width of the heavens and the earth. قَالَ نَعَمْ. The Prophet said, yes. قَالَ بَخِنْ بَخِنْ. And this is something that you say when you're surprised at something. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ مَا يَحْمِلُكَ عَلَىٰ قَوْلِكْ بَخِنْ بَخِنْ. He said, the Messenger of Allah said, what is causing you to say بَخِنْ بَخِنْ? Why did you say the statement of being surprised and taking back at beckon? قَالَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهِ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَّا رَجَاءَ أَنْ أَكُونَ مِنْ أَحْلِهَا. He said, I didn't say that except that I'm hoping that I will be from amongst the people that enter this Jannah, that enter this garden, that the width of it is the width of the heavens and the earth. قَالَ فَإِنَّكَ مِنْ أَحْلِهَا. The Prophet said, verily, you are from amongst its people, meaning you are from amongst the people of Jannah. So when the man heard this,
that Allah promised, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam promised in Jannah, فَأَخْرَجَ تَمَرَاتٍ مِّن قَرْنِهِ, and he took out some dates that he had in his sword, فَجَعَلَ يَأْكُلُ مِنْهُنَّ, and he started eating from these dates that he took out. ثُمَّ قَالَ, then he said, لَإِنْ أَنَا حَيَيْتُ حَتَّى أَكُلُ تَمَرَاتِ هَذِهِ إِنَّهَا لَحَيَاةٌ طَوِيلَةٌ, if I live until I finish eating these dates that are in my hand, it's a long life. Meaning after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam promised him Jannah, all he has to do is die and he's in Jannah. نَفَمَةُ الْمُؤْمِنِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ, the soul of the mu'min is in Jannah. He said, if I live until I finish eating these dates that are in my hand, that's a long life. It's not going to be but a couple of minutes. And he calls it a long life. رَمَى بِهَا بِمَا كَانَ مَعْهُمْ مِنَ التَّمَرِ, but he threw the dates down on the floor. ثُمَّ قَاتَلَ حَتَّى قُتِلَ, and then he fought until he was killed. وَجَاءَ نَبِي هُرَيْرَ, أَنَ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ قَالَ وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِي لَوَدِدْتُ أَنْ أَغْزُوَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ أُقْتَلْ ثُمَّ أَغْزُو ثُمَّ أُقْتَلْ ثُمَّ أَغْزُو ثم أقتل. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I swear by the one that the soul of Muhammad is in his hand, and I swear by Allah, I would love to go on an expedition fi sabilillah, in the cause of Allah, and fighting in the cause of Allah. I would love that I go fight in the name of Allah, then I get killed. Then I'm brought back alive, and then I fight again, then I get killed. Then I'm brought back alive, then I fight again, then I get killed. So we want to benefit from this, my dear brothers. So we're Muslims. We have belief about the hereafter. We're not blind like the disbelievers. Inshallah, the death of the mu'min, of the believer, is comfort. He's upon righteousness. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, من قال لا إله إلا الله دخل الجنة. Whoever says لا إله إلا الله وأنتر الجنة. No matter how long he may be in the hellfire because of his sins. Imagine if you don't have sins. It's upon us to strive for obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And remember always that we're going to return back to Allah. And the mu'min who believes in death, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded him how to prepare himself for death, then if death approaches him, then he feels confident and he looks forward to meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he doesn't sit there in doubt and sit there in confusion. No, he knows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his promise is true, and that he promised him Jannah, that he was obedient, and that he was obedient or she was obedient. And rejoice with good. Why you spend your whole life living in salah and obedience, submissiveness to Allah, so that when death is close that you live in confusion and doubt. Then you'd be more comfortable. And then the closer death comes, this makes your iman go up. This is what you lived for. This is what you dedicated your life for. That now when death comes, now you start getting doubtful. This is what you became Muslim for. This is what we want to remind each other of. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Naam, barakallahu. Naam, Tayyib. Yes, I have a question, Yaki.
Now, the people are just concerned on the current situation there in Dammaj. And are the families okay, the brothers? And are they opening up the roads? And just in general, how's the situation?
Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, mercy has been bestowed upon us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored us. And He has defended us. And He has come to our aid, and He has not abandoned us. And all of that is due for the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For nearly 40 days, the disbelievers, these Rafida, have blocked the road for us from getting any food. For the first maybe 15 days, they just blocked the road. And then after that, they started to kill students. They killed one student. So that kind of changed the vibe a whole lot. And they, the Rafida, they use snipers that shoot from far distances where you don't see them. They hide in the mountain and they shoot distance of a mile or 2 miles. When that occurred, the students here had to defend themselves and try to spot out these snipers and tried to defend themselves and get rid of these snipers. Until yesterday, they had killed 3 students, 2 men and 1 woman. And with them having us surrounded and blocking the roads, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has come to our aid. The students here killed nearly 80 of them. And we're the ones surrounded, and we're the ones without food. We have to sneak food in, literally smuggle the halal. And because of the snipers, we're not able to go certain areas except at night. And during these days, nobody wears white. Everybody wears dark color clothing. And then he's really not seen if he walks in the night. But unfortunately, yesterday, after several peace treaties that Sheikh Yahya has signed and agreed to with the Shiites, and all this is that the Shiites, they're requesting that we come down off a mountain that oversees Dammaj. It's a very high mountain. It oversees the whole area. Whoever has this mountain dominates. And that mountain, alhamdulillah, is in our hands and is fully fortified. The war previously before this, when it ended, a lot was built and fortified in the mountain so that if anybody attacked, they will not be able to get in and they won't find anything except destruction. So they want to get rid of the man, they have to take this mountain. So they stopped us from having food and all of a sudden we'll give up the mountain. But if they get in charge of this mountain, then there's no more than that. There's no more than that. That's the bottom line. So yesterday they start throwing bombs for the first time. First there was the shooting, but yesterday was the heavy bombing. It's called a mortar bomb. It goes up in the sky. It doesn't go shoot straight at his target. It goes up, and then it falls down. And they were throwing up on top of the mountain, up on top of the mountain, up on top of them. They threw about 120 bombs, which ripped the believers apart. Memorizers of the Quran and the Sunnah, memorizers of Sahih Bukhari, memorizers of the Quran. Ripped their bodies apart. They started that before Dhuhr, until after Asr. When Maghrib was close and the daylight was still apparent, then they attacked the mountain, thinking that the believers were weakened. But all they found was destruction. And they took them back fleeing by Allah's help. Alhamdulillah, about 24 brothers were killed. About 50 were injured. About 30 of the 50 is light injuries. The roads are blocked, so we can't make it to the hospital. People in need of blood, but there's no blood donation, there's no hospitals, there's no nothing. And we put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the bomber was occurring and the Rafi bus started to attack, the Muslims had to defend themselves and shoot. And of course they needed help. They need more ammunition and they need more believers to help. I was at the bottom of the mountain looking at the believers running like lions to the top of the mountain. The Shiites were spraying the mountain with the biggest of machine guns. If it hit the mountain, it would spark. While they were running, not one of them stopped. And running up a mountain is not easy whatsoever. And the mountain itself has been prepared by us. It has sandbags in it that you can run behind. You gotta go left, you gotta go right, you gotta go up, you gotta go down. You gotta bob and weave, gotta keep your head down, and bullets are flying all over the place. But alhamdulillah, I saw over 30 people go up, not one of them got hit. And we're down at the bottom making dua for them, making dua for them, making dua for them, making dua against them, making dua against them. So they thought that maybe after all the 120 to 150 bombs that they threw up there, that they would find the believers weak. So they attacked, and all they found was death. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his aid. And the Muslims, Ahl al-Sunnah, outside of the Dammaj, they are doing what they can to aid us in our situation. And this is in a nutshell what the situation here is in the Dammaj. There's no thing that caused them to attack us and do to this except the statement La ilaha illallah. We have not transgressed against them. We have done nothing to them. There's nothing except the statement La ilaha illallah wa Muhammadur Rasulullah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his protection.
Naam Akana.
Yeah, Hakeem, one more question, if you're able to take any more.
No.
Yeah, the news has gotten to us that they have been, some of the Shiites have been captured. And it's just
I don't know anything about that.
Okay.
I don't think that is true.
Okay.
Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect all of us.
Ameen.
And to allow us to die in obedience to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. When somebody dies in obedience, whether it be at the bottom of the ocean, or in an airplane that blows up, or a bullet in his head, death is only one death. It's not 2, 3, 4, 5 deaths. Only one death. That he died in obedience, no matter where he is, or no matter how it is. He's a believer. No matter where he is, no matter what the situation is, he believes in Allah and His Messenger. And if that would tell Salafia, it doesn't raise no punks. It doesn't raise many chumps. If that would tell Salafia, it raises up men who are brave and offer their soul to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Da'wah to Salafiyah doesn't raise any chumps. It doesn't raise sinners. It doesn't raise people who flirt with women. It doesn't raise people who their main concern is dunya. Those are people who have very little benefit from the Da'wah to Salafiyah. This Da'wah to Salafiyah raises up righteous people, courageous people, who don't fear anything except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umar ibn al-Khattab, he was killed. Uthman ibn al-Affan was killed. Ali ibn Abi Talib was killed. And what did them being killed deprive them or make them deficient of anything? They're the most honorable of believers. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His protection. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.